Oh, what's up, Music 101? Welcome back to my humble abode. I'm sure at this time that we can all agree that social distancing sucks. But yeah, we've got to make the best of it and move forward. And so that's what we're going to do. And today we're going to start talking about music from the Romantic period, which we are saying the Romantic era is from like 1820-ish to 1900-ish. So far, all the music that we've been talking about and listening to was composed for the church or for the people with all the money, the aristocracy. Well, except for Beethoven, however. Beethoven was never actually in the service of the aristocracy. I mean, he did have the support of some very wealthy people, but was never considered a servant in the same way that like Haydn or Bach was. In fact, Beethoven's music acts as a bridge from the classical era to the Romantic era. You might have heard at some point the term starving artist, where you have whatever, a musician or an actor and or an artist, and they're completely devoted to their music without any real prospects for making money. Well, that was actually the case for a number of the composers from the Romantic era. Yeah, they Beethoven was a model that the Romantic composers wanted to be like Beethoven, except for the fact that he was deaf. But Beethoven's image as a free artist was very inspirational to the Romantic composers. The Romantic composers began to feel the need to compose music that would leave an important legacy. The composers would spend long periods of time writing extended works that may have no immediate prospects for performance. Also, the Romantic composers were writing primarily for a middle class, which, as you know, had been growing and growing with the Industrial Revolution. So let's check out some music from the Romantic era. Check it out. That's not the one I wanted to play. Yeah, that sounds romantic to me. That's actually an excerpt from the first act of Giacomo Puccini's La Bohème. It was composed in around 1890 and is about the bohemian lifestyle and about a poor seamstress and her bohemian friends. So that's one of the pieces that you're going to be responsible for your next exam. In one of the assignments you're receiving, you're going to have listening outlines for six pieces, including that one, so that you can listen to that entire excerpt. And you're going to hear that what you're going to be listening to, the vocalist is a tenor. And then there's the orchestra provides like a gentle accompaniment to the tenor soloist. In fact, make sure you write those two pieces of information down, because those are going to be questions on the test, on the listening test. So if you need to, obviously you can pause this video at any point and make sure you take detailed notes. All right. So generally, well, one can say the artist and the writers of this time period, the Romantic era, placed a high degree of importance on individuality, imagination, extremes of emotion. And, you know, this is partly in response to the conventions of the classical era. Excuse me, the classical era was all about, you know, form symmetry, balance. And Romantic artists, however, thought that it was important to look within, to explore the unconscious, to the irrational, the worlds of dreams and fantasy. The songs and operas often glorify romantic love, nature. Composers dealt with subjects from the Middle Ages, Shakespeare, etc., etc. Yep, let's listen to another piece of music. This one's cool. This is one of my favorites. Check it out. Yeah, that's a cool piece. So that's an example of what's called, that's a German Lied. Write that down, German Lied, L-I-E-D. Or it's an art song, and this particular art song was composed in 1815 by Franz Schubert, and it's called The Erl King. So basically, this is a musical setting of a narrative ballad of the supernatural by Goethe. So the story is of a father riding on horseback through a storm with his sick child in his arms. The sick child has visions of the Erl King, who was the king of the elves and symbolizes death. So it's cool. So it's based on this underlying pulse of these relentless triplet rhythms. So it's like three notes for every beat. That's a triplet. And that's one of the questions on the listening test, the relentless triplet rhythms. And that is an example of a German Lied or art song, which is a piece of music written for solo voice and piano. And in this type of music, the piano and the voice perform complementary to each other. And these art songs were originally written to be performed in musicians' homes, but of course now they're performed all over the place, in the concert hall, etc., etc. Romantic composers also utilized the same forms of the classical era. The art song was a new innovation in the Romantic era. The Romantic composers continued to use the existing structures, the existing forms that had been created by Haydn and perfected by Mozart, Beethoven, etc., etc. But with striking differences, the Romantic works have greater ranges in tone color, dynamics, and pitch. And there's more emphasis on color and unstable tones, and less emphasis on balance and resolution. Romantic composers composed for larger and larger orchestras using a variety of different timbres, dynamic contrast. The brass, the woodwind, and percussion sections started to take on greater roles. The woodwind section grew to include the contrabassoon, the bass clarinet, English horn, piccolo. The orchestra started to add the harp, more percussion instruments. All right, so when we started with the Baroque era, the size of the orchestra was always dependent upon how wealthy the aristocratic court was. When we moved into the Classical era, the size of the orchestra began to standardize to a certain degree, where we had our four families of instruments. You know, by the time the Romantic era rolls around, where the composers are, sometimes they'll write for as many as 100 musicians. All right, so let's check out another piece of music. This one, an example of a symphony orchestra. And this one composed by a French composer named Hector Berlioz. And actually, Hector Berlioz was one of the first great French composers and was just a master of trying to find very interesting ways to combine all the different instruments. Like, you know, how is he going to write the melody? How is he going to write the accompaniment? He's going to find all kinds of interesting ways to arrange all the different instruments of the orchestra. All right, so we're going to listen to Berlioz. Just a little bit of the fourth movement of his Symphonie Fantastique. So this is entitled March to the Scaffold, and it's an example of program music, which is instrumental music associated with a story. And in this particular case, this piece is designed to express Berlioz's hopeless love, endless and unquenchable passion, quote unquote, for this actress named Harriet Smithson. And eventually this actress heard the piece and they actually married. So this is a little bit of Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique. Actually, you've heard this before. How it starts with the timpani. There's more percussion instruments used here. So more dynamic contrast. And then you hear the bassoon come in. The bassoon sounds cool. So the bassoon sitting on top of the string section. More bassoon. This is the section you're going to hear on the listening test, right here. So there's like a march-like fanfare that features the brass section. Write that down because that's one of the questions. So you'll hear that portion of the fourth movement, and then what you're hearing is like this march-like fanfare featuring the brass section. And then the other thing that you need to know about that section is that the texture is primarily polyphonic. Excuse me, the texture is primarily homophonic. Which hopefully you remember, homophonic texture means there's like a melody that's accompanied by chords. So that's three pieces that you're responsible for so far, and you have listening outlines for all three in the assignment that you're receiving. And so you can listen to the entire piece of music. Check them out. These are all very cool pieces. All right, let's move on. During the Romantic era, audiences became captivated by virtuosity. So you had these pianists such as Franz Liszt, violinists such as Niccolo Paganini that amazed audiences. The virtuosity was you have these musicians who seem to be able to do these stupidly amazing things on their instrument. Like how do they do that? And that's what we're attracted to. That we're, you know, by people who can do these amazing things. It's the same thing in sports. You know, if you're trying to sell, if you're trying to get people to buy tickets to the NBA or go see an NBA game on TV or whatever, you know, you're gonna advertise LeBron James because he can do things on the basketball court that nobody else can do, and people are attracted to that same thing in music. And so here, let's check this out. That's pretty cool. All right, so that is a composition by composer Frédéric Chopin, and it's entitled the Etude in C minor, also sometimes referred to as the Revolutionary Etude. So it's a solo piano piece, and it's an etude, and that an etude is a piece written for a musician to help them master a particular element of music. So the Revolutionary Etude was written to help the pianist develop the left hand. You can hear all the rapid passages in the low register. Of course, the main melody, when you listen to this piece, is played by the pianist's right hand in octaves. Write both those two pieces of information down. And this etude in C minor by composer Frédéric Chopin is a very important piece in piano repertoire. And, you know, it's a demonstration of what I was just talking about in terms of the this amazing ability that they had, this virtuosic ability. And Chopin actually wrote exclusively for the piano. He wrote lots of miniatures, and it presents a lot of times. His music is described as elegant, graceful, melodic. We're not going to check out any of that stuff right now, but instead, let's do this. Let's check out. Let's listen to two more pieces of music. So that'll be six. Let's listen to two arias, and then we'll be done. All right, let's do this. You might recognize this one. That's as cool as you can possibly get right there. that's a composition by Verdi. That is that's an excerpt from Act One of La Donna e Mobile, and so this is an aria. The genre is an opera, and this excerpt features the tenor. And the cool thing about that this particular recording is it features Enrique Caruso. He's one of the first great recording stars. he had like 260 recordings from 1902 to 1920. So he's one of the first huge artists. You know, the phonograph wasn't invented until like 1877 by Thomas Edison. And so recording technology and he was one of the first great stars. It's really cool. That's the fifth piece that you're responsible for. So you need to know the composer, Verdi, and that it's an excerpt from Act One of La Donna e Mobile. And then the other two pieces of information, like I said, it's an opera. This is from an opera, and you're hearing predominantly the tenor voice, Enrique Caruso. Speaking of great tenors, let's finish out. Let's do six pieces and have this final one feature another great tenor, in Luciano Pavarotti, who you may have heard of because he's one of the most financially successful opera singers of all time. He sold like over 1 million records. which is good. All right, so we're going to listen to a piece by George Bizet. This is just another little segment from the second act of Carmen. And where's it at? Yep, this is it. All right, so this is the part you're responsible for. You might have heard this one too. Yeah, that's a cool note to end on. So once again, that's Bizet's Toreador song. And what you're listening to is Pavarotti singing the character of Escamillo. So he sings this aria, and then you hear it being answered by the chorus. Write that down. That's one of the questions on the test. And the texture is, of course, homophonic, where you have the melody accompanied by the chords underneath. All right, 6 selections you're responsible for the listening test. If you have any questions about anything, send me an email, and we'll talk to you soon. Later.